We are victorious. We are victorious. Nothing can conquer us. We are victorious.
We are victorious. We are victorious. Nothing can conquer us. We are victorious.
Yeah!
We are victorious.
If you're victorious, put your hands together.
Good morning. What time does this service start? I'm not. Is it 10? Oh, you sure? Okay. All right. Just kidding. I'm glad you're all here. Happy New Year. And let's all worship together. And Ainsley's going to lead us in an opening prayer. So please stand up and let's worship.
Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, thank you for... Thank you for a new year, and thank you that we can all come together and worship you in freedom today, and pray for all those that are trying to get here on the icy roads, pray for everyone's safety, and Lord, would you just accept our worship today as an offer of sacrifice of praise to you. I ask this in Jesus' name, amen.
Time to give your heart.
Let's all pray the Sorum Prayer together. God be in my head and in my understanding. God be in my eyes and in my looking. God be in my mouth and in my speaking. God be in my heart and in my thinking. God be in my end and my departing.
Amen. You may be seated. We'll have some announcements. Yes, please greet each other, whether you know each other or not. Welcome, especially any visitors that are here.
All right, check. Microphone is hot. Our crowd is hot. Everything is good today. Hi, everybody. Good morning. Happy Sunday. My name is Nigel Berry. I'm the Youth Ministries Director here at the Ann Arbor Vineyard Church, and it's my privilege to welcome you here to our church this Sunday morning. I'm back after a month of paternity leave. We had a little girl born in our house a month ago today. Her name is Seidel Kate. She is here today, so if you're one of those people that loves to see really small people, catch me afterwards, and I'd be glad to introduce you. So with me being back today, I feel kind of new, so if any of you are new today or feeling new today, an extra special welcome. We're really glad to have you. On your way in, you may have seen we do have a vision and values booklet right at the front doors. It talks a little bit about our direction as a church and kind of what we're into, where we're going, what we hope to be able to do in our community. So if you didn't pick one of these up on your way in, feel free to grab one on your way out and learn a little bit more about us. Another way that you can do that is if you see this welcome card in the seat in front of you, if you're willing to fill that out and drop that in the offering bag as it comes along after the sermon today, we would love to follow up with you in a more personal way and just find out what brought you here, what we can do for you, what you're into, and how we might serve you best. So fill that out. If you include your mailing address, we'll send you a thank you gift for checking out our church, a compilation of some of the best songs in the Vineyard, some written by our very own Sean Garth Walker, who is in Florida right now where the sun shines. So when he's not in Florida, he's amazing. But right now, he's a little bit lame. So I hope you saw that on the internet, Sean. Love you. But a couple things I want to take a moment to highlight for you this morning. We have a few things that are coming up to put on your radar. First and foremost is an up-and-coming cereal party. Now, we are very excited about our cereal party, and it's exactly what it sounds like. It involves cereal. And so January 23rd at 6:30 p.m. right here at the church, we're going to do our annual cereal party and game night. We provide the milk, soy skim, 1 and 2%, bowls, spoons, and fruit toppings. We ask you to bring yourself, bring a friend, bring a favorite board game or game that you enjoy playing, and your favorite box of cereal. And we're just going to hang out, enjoy each other's company, get to know one another, and dominate your neighbor at Candyland. Because that's how I roll. So hope to see you guys there. It's going to be a lot of fun. Again, that's January 23rd. It's a Friday night. Also coming up on the 25th, which is Sunday, we're going to be doing a community coffee hour right after the service here at the church. And so if you're relatively new to the church, or even if you've been here for a while, you just have questions about our church community, what we're doing, you need to meet some more people, connect with one of the pastors or directors, we're all going to hang out at the coffee hour. Come by, say hi. Let us tell you stories. Let us hear your story. We'd really enjoy that. So that's going to be Sunday, January 25th. Last thing I'd like to take a moment to highlight is we are starting a new sermon series today called A New You for the New Year. So our Pastor Donnell is going to be launching that. And one of the things we'd like to do is invite you to invite others to celebrate the new year with us here at the Ann Arbor Vineyard. And so we are sending out 10,000, I believe, mailings of these out to the Ann Arbor community, just inviting people to come and experience Jesus in 2015, to reconnect, to meet for the first time, and to enjoy the good things that God has for us. And so we want to extend the invitation to you as well, that you would come and join us through this new year as we start this series, but also that you might be able to invite people in your lives to come and join us as well. And so we have a lot of these cards sitting out at the lobby as you exit today. If you would like to grab any to share with your coworkers, family, friends, mailman, I don't know, please don't be shy. Grab a handful. Invite people to the Vineyard Church in 2015. We think it's going to be a great year, and we're really excited to have you be a part of that. So at this point, I'm going to dismiss our junior high students, as a 5th grade through 8th grade at our church, out my right-hand side, back to the youth room. I'm going to hang out with you in just a minute. If you have a very small child, like I now do, we do have a cry room available on my right-hand side for nursing moms, where you can take the child. You can also take children out to the lobby where the sermon should be broadcasted there. If you have a cell phone and be willing to turn that off or to silent, that'd be greatly courteous and appreciated. And please welcome with me our pastor, Donnell.
Thanks, Nigel. Well, it is my joy. I am on. We'll see if Daniel has me on. To be with you all this morning. Happy New Year to you. And happy Epiphany. Today is Epiphany Sunday. And usually I try to get a king cake made, but it was a little busy this year, so I didn't get anyone to make one. And that's a place where you get a baby Jesus, you bake it into a cake, and then we share it after church. And then whoever gets the slice that has the baby Jesus, you're the king of the church for the year. So you missed out, but that's okay. Instead of that, can Danelle and Jeff, can you put your hands up just for us? Great. Right behind Danelle and Jeff are the sermon handouts. So why don't you grab one of those? Let's start off the new year together on the right foot. Get one of those. Get one for your neighbor. Get a Bible. We're going to be in the New Testament in John this morning. If you didn't bring one, if you have one on your phone, you can pick it up. There's this thing called the Bible app. And we're going to get started this morning. So I'm just going to pray a quick prayer while you guys move around just to fill the space, and then I'll launch. Father in heaven, we thank you for your mercy. We thank you for your grace getting us here, especially this morning with the ice and the bad roads, but here to a new year. And so we gather this morning in your presence in this community with our hands open to receive from you all that you have for us. New life, new purpose, new grace, new healing, new connections and relationships, and most especially, a new experience of your loving presence come to us. So would you be the good and beautiful God that you are and bless us? Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Albert Einstein says that life is like riding a bicycle. In order to keep your balance, you must keep moving. Keep moving. Isn't it easy to feel stuck, to find ourselves in a rut, feeling as if our lives have stalled? The new year. It's a great time to break with habits and thoughts that failed us in the old year, and to imagine a new reality. In this sermon series, A New You for the New Year, of course, I'm playing with the thing that everyone does. A friend of mine sent me the Kohl's invitation that actually has the same heading, A New You for the New Year. Why? Because the empire wants you to get rid of the old you. But we're going to talk about what Jesus wants for us this year. What we're going to do over the next several weeks is we're going to spend several weeks together taking consideration of what it means to become transformed. And here's a little bit of what I've been thinking about. Maybe you're like me and we want to deepen our relationship with God. Maybe you're interested in deepening your relationship with your friends and your family members, each other. Perhaps you want to break some of the habits of old that were robbing you of life. Or maybe you just want to start practicing gratitude and then discovering the joy that it produces. So here's my pitch, my ask, as it were. Stick with us over the next several weeks while we learn from the Bible and Jesus how to surrender ourselves, our minds, our wills, our hopes, our dreams to Him, and learn to trust ourselves with God and His care and provision for us. Happy New Year. Happy New Year. Such a power-packed phrase. This simple phrase, it holds so much promise, so much boldness, so much potential. Happy New Year. You just have to smile when you say it, right? I mean, it just evokes all of this leaning into. It invokes this hope packed with fortitude within us. It just gets us in the right posture. I feel trapped up here. It gets us in the right posture, the right frame of mind. Why? Because it opens up all of this potential, these unanswered, open-ended questions. What will this new year be like? What will the relationships and connections that I create in this new year be like? Will things finally work out for me at school, at work, in my personal relationships? What will the future hold for me? Will I finally finish high school, start a new job, go back and get my degree that I never completed? Will I finally shed those extra pounds that I've been carrying around? Will I get healed? Will I meet someone to share my life with? Will I? Happy New Year. It invites us to forget everything that happened last year. Don't worry. Be happy. Leave the past in the past. We rehearse this almost as if it's a mantra. Happy New Year. We have so much to look forward to. We are greeting and welcoming a new year, and because it's new, maybe there'll be a new me too. The Babylonians, they're credited with creating the Happy New Year celebration, a New Year's celebration. They were a clever bunch. What they did is they took an unremarkable passing of time of no significance, one day to the next, and they infused it with so much hope, promise, and potential. And when they did it 4,000 years ago, they really knew how to celebrate the new year. They had an 11-day celebration of the new year. So at the end of it, guess what? You couldn't remember what happened before, right? You were just so like wasted and just recovering from this 11-day just feast on what was new. But in an interesting way of thinking about it, what they did is they took something that in a matter of a second, this idea that we move from one year to the next, and they just gave it new meaning. Everything that was is gone. It's banished into the abyss. Behold, it's a new day. It's a new year. It's a new you. And there's so much promise that's in that. And this celebration of celebrating the passing of one year to the next, it's as universal as breathing. Almost every culture on this planet celebrates the passing of another year. Why? Because it's the perfect occasion for us to take inventory of the past 365 days, unless it's a leap year, and reflect. Sometimes looking back on regrets and failures and mistakes, but also sometimes looking back, reflecting with hope and gratitude. I made it. Maybe this year will be better. And this propels us forward, making resolutions to ourselves and to others. Our resolutions, you know, they're about our feeling better about ourselves. You can hear us almost saying, I want this year to be better than last year. It's all potential. It's all promise. It's all hoping. It's all leaning in to the desire to live a healthier, stress-free, and longer life. And here's the beautiful thing. Jesus wants the same thing for you. He just wants us to have that and a little bit more. Now, many of us, our resolutions are centered around what the culture tells us that we should be ashamed of or focused on, right? Diet, exercise, organizing, right? That's all you got if you subscribe to any of those mills, right? I got our postcard in the mail for Liberty Athletic. Come in January and February's free. I was like, how do we use that for the church? Come in January and the rest of the year is free, right? All right, good. Use that when you're passing out your postcard. Or Kohl's, for instance, right? They're wanting you to think about your new you, so they're advertising for athletic clothes so that you will do what? Go to the gym, right? Or those container stores, which are giving you like 25% off because you have to do something with all those Christmas gifts you got, right? Last year. You have to pack them away now, right? So you can re-gift them next year. No, sorry. Did I tell on anyone? It's okay. We'll take it. Jesus wants us to live lives of meaning and purpose. He wants us to live lives that are full of hope and are full. He wants us to live lives that are free from anxiety and worry. He wants us to live lives that are dependent on God. Hear Jesus as he says in John chapter 10, starting in verse 7. Therefore, Jesus said again, very truly I say to you, I am the gate for the sheep. All who have come before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep have not listened to them. I am the gate. He's invoking an image, a pen where sheep are kept, and he is talking about that he is the entryway into that pen. He is the gate. Whoever enters through me will be saved, he says. They will come in and go out, and they will find rest, pasture, food, water, everything that we need. The thief, he says, only comes to kill, steal, and destroy, but Jesus says that he has come so that we may have life, and not regular, ordinary, just getting by, living quiet lives of desperation life. No, he's saying that you get to have life that's abundant and full. It's overflowing. That's the kind of life that he wants for us. He finishes this up by saying, I am the good shepherd, and the good shepherd lays down his life for his sheep. See, our New Year's resolutions are our attempt to take control over what went wrong last year and to prevent it from happening again in the new year. But we're already led astray because we have believed the misnomer of the new year, since nothing has actually changed in us on New Year's Day. Now, we may resolve to, but until we actually do, everything is the same. That's because transformation doesn't happen all at once. It doesn't happen in an instant. And it's also not a mere exercise of our will, in spite of us willing it to be so. Our transformation involves our desire to change, our will, but it doesn't end there. I think our transformation starts with surrender. About 92% of us fail completely at our New Year's resolutions, and so we have resolved what? Not to have any this year. That way we can be successful. No, am I the only one that did that? 50% of us who set up resolutions, by the end of January, we've abandoned them. We fail because we don't understand how change works. When people decide to change something about themselves, they believe that they can muster up their willpower and set about to change whatever behavior they have under inspection. Except change isn't a matter of will. Our transformation, as I said, starts with surrender. Hear Matthew chapter 11, starting in verse 28. Come to me, all who are weary and burdened, and I, Jesus says, will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, he invites. Why? Because I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. My yoke is easy, my burden is light. Now, he's invoking a bunch of images that we don't live with every day. He's talking about oxen being yoked together and plowing a field, right? And what he's inviting us to do is to be yoked with him. Two oxen together. I was watching The Amazing Race, and one of the things they had to do in some country they were in was get these oxen, and then it had a plow. I think it was like in a South Asian country, because it was where they were doing something with rice, and buried in these rice fields were these ropes, and they had to get these oxen to move. And I don't know about you, but I've never tried to get oxen to do anything. And it was really fun for me, entertaining, watching them just fail miserably, trying to get these oxen to do anything. That's the image that he's invoking, is that you have these oxen, they're set aside in the field, they're yoked together, and because they're yoked together, they can accomplish a lot. But Jesus is offering a different way of thinking about it, and he's saying, instead of you having to do all of the work, guess what? I'm going to do most of the work for you. Take my yoke upon you, because my burden is light. Yoke yourself with him, is what he's saying. This is a surrender invitation, and that's where transformation begins. It begins at this place because we have to be willing to believe something about ourselves. Something that Jesus teaches us, something that I'm hoping that I'm going to unpack over the next several weeks, which is we're not who we think we are. It's hard to accept what Jesus is offering unless we are willing to take seriously the possibility that what we presently believe is not true. Let me just say that again, because it's a lot of words strung together. It's hard to accept what Jesus is offering us as true, unless we are willing to take seriously the possibility that what we currently believe is not true. At our best, our will is a decision point. It's a decision point in our process of transformation. It's the place of desire. I want to. You fill in the blank. Our will, then, is like a compass that will take us to that geocache. Does anyone geocache here at the church? I know a couple people do, right? There are these little buried treasures of, you know, worth to somebody that are buried all over the country. And you can get an app on your phone and you download it and then you use a compass and you go and find the treasure. And then when you go, you can take anything out, but you also are supposed to put something in. And our will is about that compass, that pointing us. Before you can find your treasure, you have to make sure you're going in the right direction. The compass, our will, that desire points the way, but we actually have to do something to get where we want to go. Take, for instance, this parable from Jesus. It's the parable of two sons. It's also found in Matthew. What do you think? Jesus asks. There was a man who had two sons. He went to the first and said, "Son, go and work in the vineyard today." The son said, "I will not." But later he changed his mind and went and worked in the vineyard. The father then went to his other son. We don't know if he did that after or before or at the same time, but that's okay. And he said the same thing. This son answered, "I will, sir," but he didn't go. Which of the two did what the father wanted? Right? The first son. Why? Because even though he said he wasn't going to go, he actually went ahead. See, on the surface, this parable seems really straightforward and simple. One father, two sons, one request, one action. But hidden in the field of this parable is a core truth about our will and our willingness. Our will is not the same thing as our character. And so I want to share a quick story with you about it. So early on in my relationship with my wife, Maria, she would ask me to do things. And I would immediately say no. Now, I had learned something about myself over time. We've been married now for 12 years. This is our 13th year being married, so we're grateful for that, or at least, yes, we're grateful for that. And coming into that relationship, I had learned something about myself. It was better for me to set my expectations for others by lowering them instead of doing what I had previously done, which was overcommitting and under-delivering. And what would happen as a result of that? Well, I would suffer the disappointment of others as I failed to do what I said I was going to do because I failed to follow through. So, turning over a new leaf in my relationship with Maria, I decided to try something different. I said, I'm not going to commit to doing something unless I can do it at the moment at which I'm asked to do it. So that whole, like, if I can't do it right here and there, I'm not going to do it. So when she would ask me to rake the leaves and I didn't want to, I would say, no, I will not rake the leaves. Because I didn't want her expectation to be, I'm going to go and rake the leaves later. When the snow was falling and she was pregnant with one of our kids and she said, "Hey, will you go out and shovel the snow?" I'd say, "No, I will not go and shovel the snow. Because I don't want to put on any clothes and go out there." The story gets better. It's not so good right now. When it's, I know all of you are like, "Wow, that was really great. Good job. You're like the husband of the year." I'm just being honest. It's the middle of the night. The kids have bananas every morning. We're out of bananas. She reaches over and she says, "Hey, will you get up and go and get bananas?" "No, I will not get up and go and get bananas." And then, thanks, Debbie. And then I start to wonder, like, why is it that Sebastian is so quick to tell us, he's our 2.5-year-old son, what he will not do? And I was like, oh yeah, there might be a correlation here. Well, to say that Maria was, you know, disappointed is an understatement, right? Completely disappointed, hurt, and put off by my quick negative replies to her requests. But she discovered something about me. This is why I'm getting at this whole will and character thing. Because there's this sort of deception that I think we have where we see ourselves differently than we actually are. Our character is sort of made up of our actions. Not the desires that we want to do, but the things that we actually do. And what Maria discovered as our marriage and our life together unfolded was, while I was quick to say no, I worked really hard to get to yes. So often I do get the bananas. And I do now shovel all the snow. She did shovel the snow for a while, but that's because she liked it and she said she would. And I said we'd get a service, but she said she'd happily do it. She grew up on a farm or a big acreage and she liked doing things like that. I refused to mow the grass, so I'm going to maintain that one. So that one is all hers, waiting for Michaela to get old enough to do it herself for us. Let's jump back to the parable in Matthew. Jesus asks a question about will and willingness. Which of the two did what the Father wanted? The first, even though he told the Father he wasn't going to do it. Let me play a little bit with the words that we're looking at here. Will, willingness, and willfulness. Remember, will is at the center of our desire. It's an indication of our intent. Willingness is a surrender of our individuality. It's about our joining in. It's the realization that we're a part of something larger, something cosmic, something grand. It's a commitment to participate in a larger story that's unfolding around us that includes us. It's at the foundation of what Jesus invites us into when he says, "Come and follow me." All it requires is our willingness. Finally, willfulness is something where we set ourselves apart from the whole. It's the classic, I'll do it on my own, I don't need anyone, that mentality. We don't need others, or we say that we don't need others because I believe falsely, that we know what we want and we know how to get it. I mean, just as I was writing this sermon, I went through all three of the cycles of this. Maria wanted me home for dinner at a certain time, and my intent was to get home at that time. And I was willing to get home at that time, but I was willful, and I didn't get home at that time, which caused some apologies when I got there. Jesus says this, "Come to me, all who are weary and burdened, and I," Jesus says, "will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, because I am gentle and humble of heart, and you will find rest for your souls. My yoke is easy, my burden is light." This is how transformation begins, with our trust and our willingness. When Jesus encounters someone in the New Testament, there's a consistent pattern. If you go and you just read through, let's say, the Gospel of Mark, it's the short one, so we don't want to go through the long one, which would be Matthew, stay away, and Luke, which is even longer. But let's just start with Mark, right? Every encounter Jesus has with someone in the Gospel follows the same pattern. He encounters them and invites them to consider that he has a better way for them to live their lives. In every encounter, he has something to offer. So as we welcome in the new year, we don't tend to look at what we're doing right. We always tend to focus on our bad habits, our flaws, our weaknesses, the things we want to change. But friends, let me just offer you some encouragement this morning. God sees us differently. We're being invited by God to join him in living in his kingdom, under his rule, under his reign. Jesus says these words, "Trust me and I'll show you the way." Learn to entrust yourselves to God. And as we do this, we'll learn together how to live without worry, to live without anxiety, to live without fear. And the good news is this, our habits aren't our destiny. They can be changed. The science echoes this. I'm going to talk more about this through the series. But transformation takes time. It takes time. Has to start somewhere, but it takes time. You can break the habits that prevent you from experiencing the kind of life that Jesus offers, and you are being invited, along with me and everyone, to form new habits and practices which transform us. We start this transformation simply by believing something about what Jesus is saying, that it's true, that he has the keys to life, that when we give up our way of living life and we accept his, we experience something real, something palpable, something tangible. We become closer, we get closer and closer to being what he's calling us into. We don't repay evil with evil. We learn how to love our enemies, right? I mean, this is probably one of the hardest ones that we have because, first of all, none of us believe we have any enemies. So we just ignore this and we treat people with contempt sometimes. And Jesus says, no, they're made in my image. They deserve the same dignity and respect and love that you do. But it's hard for us to realize, oh, yeah, we might have some enemies. Do good to those who curse you, he says. Bless, he invites. Serve, he calls us to. Look out for those who are at the margin and make space for them by welcoming them in. And we do this because God first loved us. Here, John chapter 4, verse 19. We love because we were first loved. We start our transformation here with our acceptance of God's kindness, his forbearance, and his patience towards us. Imagine with me one of those dreaded trust fall exercises, right? If any of you have ever worked anywhere that they want you to build a team, you know what this thing is about, right? There are these dreaded ones because sometimes people drop you and you've been hurt. Yeah, I know Gary's like, I've been dropped. All right, thanks, Gary. It's this whole idea that you have to trust the people around you to care for you and to catch you, as it were, when you fall. Accepting God's kindness, forgiveness, and patience is just like one of those trust fall exercises. It's just like it because, it's just like it, except it's slightly different, which is this. You can't see who's going to catch you. At least when you're doing those trust falls, you can size up the people so you know to fall on this side because these people seem a little stronger and they're really gonna, you know, they're committed to it, right? Or you rearrange the people so that you know that you're gonna fall in the right place, or at least that's how I would do it. Accepting God's kindness, forgiveness, and patience is just like that, except you can't see who's gonna catch you. And this is the rub. Right? I know I've been up until this point saying how easy it is, but now I'm going to like slightly change it and tell you it's really hard, but that's okay because I convinced you it was easy, so you're here with me. Great. Here's the rub. This requires a very active letting go. You know, imagine that you've been holding on to a rope for dear life, and Jesus says, trust me. And you go, but Jesus, I have the rope. And he's like, yeah, but I have everything else you want. And you're like, yeah, but I have the rope, Jesus. And he's like, yeah, but I have everything else that you want. He's like, yeah, but don't you realize this rope is really comforting because I have it, right? But Jesus is saying, trust me. So we have to let go. We have to let go of our fear, our control, our power, and we have to fall. And this is the scary part. This is the difficult part. But look, getting life it's going to cost us everything, right? We have to fall into powerlessness. We have to fall into vulnerability. We have to suspend our disbelief that God doesn't love us, that he's not coming to us, and we have to trust that we're falling up. Not down, but up into God's love, his kindness, his forgiveness, his acceptance of us. Here, Romans chapter 2, verse 4. Don't you see how wonderfully kind, tolerant, and patient God is with you? That's Paul speaking to the Romans. Does this mean nothing to you? He asks. These are not rhetorical questions. Can't you see that it's his kindness that is intended to turn you from your sin, your participation in the rebellion, your decision to say, I'm going to go it alone. As you surrender, consider who you're actually surrendering to. You're surrendering to a God that Jesus trusted with his entire life, who he said was always good and beautiful and is always at work for you and for your benefit. Hear Romans again, chapter 8, verse 31 and 32. What then shall we say in response to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up freely for all of us, how he will not also, along with him, graciously give us all things. Now, when we hear this, or when I hear it, I go, well, Jesus, I'd like this, I'd like this, I'd like that, right? You're like, you're ticking off all these material things in your mind. Maybe that's just me, and I'm sharing too many of my sins this morning. But what if the thing that Jesus is offering us, actual life, encompasses all things? No, in spite of all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. Right? He's saying, this is the God that you are trust falling into, his care for you, his provision for you, his love for you, his ability to redeem every single solitary thing that happens to you and around you and in your life. This is the good and beautiful God who can be trusted. This is the God that Jesus knew, who is good to his core. And it starts with this basic truth that God is good all the time. And it is an invitation for us to see his kindness, his patience, his forbearance with us as a way for us to turn from our willfulness, our participation in the rebellion, and to trust him with our lives. I have some practical tips for us. There are two authors that are super helpful to me, and I think will be to you if you're open to it. A man by the name of James Brian Smith, and a guy named Dallas Willard. Dallas Willard died, I think, last year sometime in the spring or 2 years ago. And he was a philosophy professor at the University of Southern California, but a prolific Christian writer and formation, like spiritual formation. And what we're really going to be talking about, just between us, is spiritual formation over the next several weeks. But I'm not going to call it that because all of us shut down when we hear those words. Like, oh, spiritual disciplines? Oh. So we're just going to talk about habits and practices and life. That's what we're going to talk about, all right? But for those of you who are wondering, like, what's he really getting at? Spiritual formation. That's it. That's all we're dealing with. And today what I wanted to do was just start with surrender. I think we all are being invited to surrender before the King. Whether we've decided when we were 13, like I did, to follow him, and we've been following him faithfully ever since, or whether you're here today because you made a resolution to bring more spirituality into your life, I think we're all on the same path, and we all can learn from Jesus how to enter into more life. And that's my payoff. Like, honestly, what I'm hoping to do is to see us really take Jesus seriously and to invite the life that he has for us to come into our lives, really. That's all I'm going to be working on over the next several weeks. And I hope you will endeavor with me as we do this. And what we're planning, and I have a team, there's a team of us who are praying and thinking about all of this, and some of them are way smarter than me, which is really good, and they know how to do spiritual formation in this way. And so they're helping contribute ideas of how we're going to do this together as a congregation. So back to Dallas Willard and James Byron Smith. They have a reliable method for how we change our lives. And I want to offer it to you, and then the sermons are actually going to expand on each of them. They offer this. It's not complicated, and it's not difficult, and it doesn't rely on our willpower. So what they have is this thing called the triangle of transformation. All right, great. There you go. So now you can, like, whoa. I don't know, we can come up with a better name, right? One of you can. Just email it to me, and we'll go with that. Here are the four elements of the triangle of transformation. First element is about changing the stories we tell ourselves. So next week, I'm going to talk about that. Talk about learning new stories about Jesus, about God, and about ourselves. And this is also about renewing our mind. Two, they invite us to invite new practices. This is the action stuff, right, that we do. And so we're going to talk about how to form new habits of inviting God's presence. Some of you have been trying out some of the habits that we did in the Advent series, so we're just going to continue with that momentum into this new series. Three, they invite us to get into community to do this. And so this, for a lot of us, may be the hard part because a lot of us want to do it on our own. And the number one thing that the science tells us about changing habits is you will fail if you try to do it on your own. Now, some of you are like, that's a challenge. Watch, I'm going to do this by myself, and I'm going to prove you wrong. Great. I welcome that challenge. Let's do it, okay? You know, let me know how it goes. But for the rest of us, we need a community to help us as we navigate. And then finally, the fourth and most important part of the triangle of transformation is that we do this all under the submission, the leading, and the guidance of the Holy Spirit. Because it's the Spirit of God that leads us to repentance and to change and to transformation. So we're going to be unpacking this over the next several weeks, hopefully having some fun as we do it. And like I said, I hope you'll hang out with us. But here's what we want to do this morning. I want to invite you to do three things. First is I want to invite you to consider learning or being open to, being willing to trust yourself to God. And I just want to sit in that for just a moment because, as a matter of fact, we have a team of folks who are gathering now before the celebration to pray and ask God, what's he saying to us? And to share that with the congregation. And this morning, one of the team members had this sharing, and I want to share it with you. And when you come up for communion, you can come over to the prayer station, and someone will pray for you if this is meaningful for you. And here's what he said. He says, there are some of us who are here who have been holding God at a distance. You know, it's almost, you know, like you see that running back, and that tackler's coming, and he stiff-arms him. That's your picture, right? You're stiff-arming God. He's like running towards you, but you think he's running with discipline and correction and everything that's bad, and so you're stiff-arming God. You're like, no, I got it. I have my life right here in this football. You stay away from me because you tackle me, I'm going to drop my life. And God's like, but I have a better life, and I'll carry you right to the touchdown, right? I mean, I almost got that football analogy working. It's like middle school was the last time I played football, or any sport for that matter. Unless you think programming, like Matt and I, we could have competitive programming sports, so that might be fun. Anyway, that was a nerd moment for those of you who weren't there. He says, so you're holding God at a distance, you're stiff-arming God, and it's because you're afraid to go into a deeper commitment. You're afraid to trust God. You don't trust his Father's heart for you. And there's so much that can be unpacked in that, but if that's you, like if at any point in what I was sharing, it resonates and you're like, oh yeah, I am sort of keeping God at bay. You know, like I'm not inviting him into every aspect of my life, and you want to change that? It's the new year. It's a new you. You don't have to be the old you who stiff-armed God. Today you can start new and say to God, all right, I'm going to try this, and if you screw my life up, dude, I'm going to be so pissed off at you. I am never going to talk to you again. Fine, he's cool with that because he's good at his core. He's working for your benefit. So my first invitation is to just learn or just to open yourself up to a willingness to trust yourself to God. All right, here's the second one. The second one, and this one's something to do on your own, and I think it's on the sermon handout. If not, it'll be on the website, which is this. It may be helpful for some of us as we approach the new year to write down our hopes and our dreams and present them to God in prayer. So all you're doing is just writing them down. You can even just put them on your cell phone, and you just put your cell phone in your hand and before God and just sort of offer it that way, right? Because if you don't like journaling or you don't have paper or pen, just do it with what you have. And as you do this, try to become aware of the way that you're striving on your own to achieve these hopes and dreams. And think about how you're expecting others to get with your plans and to help you. Now, why am I inviting you to do this? Here's why. Because doing this will give God a chance to speak to you about whether he has the same hopes and dreams for you. And if so, whether we're trusting him to bring them into fruition or if we're trusting ourselves to make them happen. So that takes a little bit of time because you got to really be honest. And here's the thing. Let me just give you an inside tip on this. Don't lie. I mean, you laugh because the possibility that you might exist. That's it, right? I mean, because you're like holding, that's the holding back part. Like the thing you want, the thing you're hoping for this year, the thing you're dreaming about this year, the thing that, I read something that I thought was absolutely toxic, which was some famous author said, whenever you say an idea out loud, it kills it. And I was like, oh, that's so toxic. Why? Because the way the culture thinks about stuff. We can trust God with our dreams and our hopes. We don't have to hold that back. And if we believe something about God, that he's all-knowing, guess what, friends? He already knows it. And he still likes you. He's not afraid of your ambition. Okay? So that's the one. And then in the time that we have remaining, here's what I want to do today. So over the next several weeks, we're going to be focusing, I hope, on a single spiritual practice, and it's called the practice of being present. And if you follow me on Facebook, which you can, I don't post a lot of crazy stuff, so you can go up and follow me, and I have filters now, so people, if I post things that are bad, they text me and say, take it down, and I do, so don't worry. It's a safe place. And someone had posted photos for 2014 of the president of the United States, and it was from the White House. And what struck me was how many times I saw the president practicing the spiritual discipline of being present. So I'm going to link to it and put it online so you can take a look at it. There's about 40 photos, and at least I think 8 of them are of him being present. He gets off the plane, and it's a beautiful sunset. And so what does he do? He skips getting into the limo, and he goes stands on the edge of the tarmac, and he's present. That's a spiritual discipline of inhabiting the space that you're in, and God confers it to us. He does it over and over and over again. And I was sitting there, and I just felt the presence of God just saying, this is what I want. I want you, he was talking to me, and by extension now I'm giving it to you, to practice being present. And so I want to give you some ways of doing that. And here are my first three little invitations for it, and then the band can make their way back. The first way of trying being present is this. Relax. Jesus says, tomorrow has enough cares and worries of its own. You don't have to join to them today. Relax. The second thing is this. Learn to trust God for later. I think that one's going to be the hard one for a lot of us because we feel like it's that football that we're carrying and God is that left tackle that's coming. Did I get that right? And we have to now stiff arm him so that he doesn't cause us to fumble our life. When in fact, God is coming in to assist us so that we can get across. You can't do that in football because if you do it, it's a penalty. So I'm mixing all kinds of metaphors there, but that's okay. Some of you are smiling because you're smarter than me, and that's good. Trust God for later. The third thing is relax. Because as soon as you release it, you're going to want to take it back. So you got to relax again, or else you're going to take it back. The Hebrews have this thing. It's a psalm. It says, it talks about casting your cares onto God. The word for the cast is fling. It's not like toss so that you can get it really quickly. It's like you really, really cast it away. And that's what the invitation is. And then here's the actual practice, which is be present in the space that you're in. Right? So one of the ways that I am sinful in this is I carry my cell phone with me everywhere. And even when I'm at lunch or meeting with someone, I'm constantly checking my cell phone. Here's a way to practice the spiritual discipline of being present. Turn the cell phone over. Put it in silent. And then make an agreement with the person that you're eating with that if I pick up my phone or you pick up your phone, then whoever does that pays for the meal. It just gives a nice little incentive for you to keep the phone out of the conversation and to allow you to be more present with each other in the space. All right? We have two other things that I want to let you know about. One, if you're here today and you haven't ever surrendered to Jesus, we have these surrender cards right here. Pick one of these up. It's a prayer that's useful for all of us. And then for the sermon series, we've printed out prayer cards, which you can use as a way of being present. When you want to practice the spiritual discipline of being present, take the card. It's a business card size, so it can fit in pretty much anything you have. Type it out, put it on your phone so that you can keep it with you. Take a photo so you have it. And then when you want to practice the thing, just pull it up, start with the prayer, and then inhabit the space that you're in. Come alive to it. See what God is doing in it. What he's saying to you, to the other. What do you see? What do you smell? What do you feel? What does it mean for you to be in this space at this moment? And see if you won't come alive to God's presence. We're going to talk more about that. The band's going to lead us in the offering. Shona Chimbira is going to come and lead us into communion. And then we're going to be done for this morning. We'll have more worship. All right?
As we prepare to take our offering, we'd like to remind all of you that filled in any of the cards from the seat pocket, a welcome card, a prayer card, or an offering card, now you can hand them in. Simply place the cards in the offering basket as it goes around. Or if you'd like to fill in a card now, please feel free to do so, and you can give it to anybody wearing a name tag. We have a giving kiosk in the lobby for those who would like to give by credit card, and we also have online giving options, which you can get more information about if you fill in the green giving card. Let's all pray together for the offering. Lord Jesus, we gratefully welcome this new year as a fresh start filled with new hopes, new dreams, and new promises. In all that we do, we hope to seek your way and draw on your strength and wisdom as we invite renewal in all areas of our lives. You came and gave your life for us, so that we could have life abundantly. And in turn, we humbly submit ourselves to you. We're so grateful for the financial resources that you've blessed us with. And as good stewards, we faithfully surrender our tithes and offerings back to you for the glory of your kingdom. In your name, amen. You can remain seated as we sing the doxology.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above you, heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son,
there we go. It's so wonderful to have you all here as one church, one celebration. If there's anyone that's visiting us, a warm welcome to you especially. And we'd like to let you know that our communion table is an open table, which means that you're very welcome to come down and join in communion with us. And just so you know, our communion meal comes served as a cup inside of a cup. The fruit of the vine will be in the top cup, and the bread will be in the bottom cup. There's a gluten-free option available for those that might need that. And if you ask for that on my right, Lindsay will give that to you. Could we all stand for communion, please? Lord, we come to your table and we offer all of our hopes and dreams for the year ahead to your care, for we trust you. We also ask that you renew our thinking, that we may know you. Restore our bodies, that we may worship you. Refresh our senses, that we may experience more of you. Revitalize our hearts, that we may share more fully in your love, and receive us with your loving grace. We come to the Lord's table to receive his body, which was given for us, and also to drink from the cup of salvation for the forgiveness of sins. For Jesus declared, "Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never go thirsty." So with this meal, we honor our Lord with praise and thanksgiving, and we also all pray together with the words that he gave us, which go, "Our Father in heaven, holy is your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins. And lead us not into sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, ever and ever. Amen." So we'll come to communion in two rows down the center. And if you'd like any kind of prayer, please come meet us in the prayer station. We'll be there to pray for you. Thanks.
presence, I will find my joy.
Amen. Let's do one more song real quick.
Because God has said, never will I leave you, never will I forsake you. And may the God of all grace, who called you to his eternal glory in Christ, after you have suffered a little while, himself restore you and make you strong, firm, and steadfast. Amen.
Thanks, everyone. We'll see you next week.
take your rightful place. We welcome you with praise. We welcome you today. The people of God in the presence of God, pouring out the praises of God. We welcome you. We welcome you. Jesus, here. Jesus, here.
You look so much better when you're.
I say,
you look so much better when you're. remember.
You look so much better when you smile.
Come on. Power, y'all.
Fell from heaven.
Came
like
down from heaven. Hardships, difficulties.
Right now.
Tears, storms. This is what I do.
I smile.
Woo.
Even though I hurt, see, I smile.
Boy, that feels good.
I know God is working, so I smile.
All things are working.
Even though I've been here for a while.
Still.
I smile. Smile.
Hallelujah.
It's so hard to look up when you've been down.
I know it's hard right now.
Show
you're a winner.
You look so much better when you smile.
You look better.
So smile. Oh, oh, oh.
Dallas.
You look so much better when you're
home. New Orleans.
You look so much better when you're home.
Come on. Cleveland.
You look so much better when you're home.
Detroit.
You look so much better when you're home.
You to be happy, but then you gotta have something happening. I want you to have joy, cause can't nobody take that from you. I see you smiling.
We are victorious.